JavaScript, it has always been hard to deal with asynchronous code. For some people, it's even a phobia in JavaScript. Because traditionally, when you deal with JavaScript, it's hard to keep your code base maintainable and readable. Today, I want to make you a promise, and I will make you a lot of promise. And the promise is that at the end of my talk, you will be able to write your code asynchronously, like it's synchronous code. So, little introduction before beginning. My name is Jordan Bonnard. I work at Viseo, which is an IT service company. I'm based in Paris. You can come us and watch the Viseo Asia stand. We will talk to you a lot about all the buzzwords you want, chatbot, IoT, and there is blockchain, etc. In Viseo, I'm a JavaScript developer mainly, so front-end and back-end, with Node.js, AngularJS, React, etc. Since 1 year, I'm also an Elm programmer. It's a very great language, a new language for front-end development that is really a game changer. You can go have a look if you want to get it. And in my mission, I do a little bit of Java. But the main thing to know about me is this. I love TV shows. I really love them. In fact, I watch so many of them that I can't keep track of every episode I need to watch. So I have something, a French website, which is called Beta Series, that helped me to keep track of every episode I need to watch. As you can see, I'm a bit late because I have 160 episodes to watch. based on that website, on the API of that website, I've created a small dashboard to show my profile. So as you can see, we have my username, some statistics about me just below. Below, you have a list of my friends. And on the right, a randomly picked show among the show I'm watching. So if you see something shameful, please be nice. let's have a look at the code base. We have two main files, so app.js and beta series API.js. So the first one is an utilitary file with many functions to contact the API, make some calls and get the data. So for example, this function will allow me to authenticate myself and the API. This one will allow me to get my information. This one to get the character of the show, and the last one to get my phone. Okay. So, as you can see, we're dealing with asynchronous code here with callback, which is a traditional way in JavaScript to deal with asynchronous code. So you give callback to a function, and when you get the data, you call the callback with the data. Or if there is an error, you can specify as first argument an error. So here is a second file. So we don't need all that, it's just to display. Here we have an interesting and complex function which allows me to display my friends. We'll come back to that later. And at the end of the file, we have all the code that will really display the dashboard. So first, I authenticate myself. I get the user data in return, in a callback, as you can see. After every possible error, and then I will get my user info based on my token I just get. Again, we are dealing with possible errors, and then I will get the show character and my friend in parallel. The first thing we can notice here is that we have a lot of closing brackets at the end of the file. It's usually a symptom of what we are calling the callback hell. It means you're nesting a lot of asynchronous code, and you will nest more and more your calls, so add a lot of indents, and you produce a code that is not readable and not maintainable. So as you can see, you can't really know what this code is doing at first sight. So we want to improve that. The other thing is that we are dealing with errors everywhere in the code, but basically we are doing always the same thing. if there is an error, we want to interrupt the execution of the code and just log it into the console. So maybe we can find a way to deal with errors in a single place. We'll see how we can do that. Until ES6, we had very few tools to handle asynchronous code, but since ES6, we had a lot of it. So we have a lot of new tools. Who is using ES6 now in its project? Very few people. It's been 2 years that ES6 is out, so it should be used very well.
How do I know it's ES6?
I read some JavaScript code. How do I know it's ES6? Okay. For example, here I'm using the arrow function, which is a way to create lambda bit specific, so it's typically ES6. There are other things like const I'm using here, that is a keyword only in ES6. Okay, so what kind of tools does ES6 bring to us to handle asynchronous code? The first one are promise. So what is a promise? A promise is kind of a box that will encapsulate a value. And this value can have three states. A pending state, that means we are waiting for the value. A state result with success, or okay. Or a state where it's resolved in error. So it's used to encapsulate an asynchronous value that we will, for example, get from a server, and use it whenever it's ready. So, an example, just imagine MySQL returns a promise. If you want to consume the value once it is resolved with success, you will use the then method. You just give the then method a callback, so it's not really different, but you will see it's very useful later. And if you want to catch the error, you can use the catch method. So, as you can see, we are already separating the two scenarios between success and failure. So how do you create a promise? In ES6, you have a new global keyword, global object, the promise object, that you can use as a constructor to create a promise. You will give it a function with two parameters, result, that is a function that allows you to resolve your promise, and reject, that allows you to reject your promise. So, usually you will do your asynchronous operation, and when you want to resolve your promise, you're just using the resolve function. If you want to reject it, you can use the reject function. So here, my function give async call returns a promise. So we will try to use that into our code base. So. And this function, authenticate user, that we've seen earlier, we have a callback for now, but what we want is return a promise. So we will make the callback optional because we want the code to still work while we're doing that, but in a true case, you won't do that, you will just switch to promise. So here, let's just add a little condition to make it optional. Okay, now we will create a promise. Okay. So we need to nest all that code inside our function. And now what we want is resolving that promise right here. So we're using resolve, giving the same data than before. And if there is an error, we want to reject it. So now, nothing has really changed because we're still using the callback in our code, but we can return a promise also that we can use. If we have a look, it's still working. Okay, now we need to transform the other function, but I've already done that, as you can see. We have already of returning a promise. So let's go back to our code. And now we will replace, for example, the more nested call, this one. And instead of using the callback, we will use the promise. So we don't need that callback anymore. Let's go to this slide. Here, that call returns the promise, so we can consume it with the Zen method. Getting for a friend, and then we can just display them. We can just display them, and if there is an error, don't forget to catch it. As you can see, the code is already more dense and more readable. We'll do the same with that call right here, so we don't need the callback anymore. Using the Z method and displaying my characters. Still catching the errors. Okay. It's a little bit more dense, so let's continue. Okay. We're getting some user info. Here we need to take all that code and put it inside. Okay. Don't forget to catch the errors. Okay, still better. And the last one is this one. So the code is more compact, it's better, it's more readable, but we still have a lot of indents and we're still dealing with errors everywhere. So it's not really good. Maybe we can do better. Something that a few people seem to know about promise, but that is really their strength, is that you can chain promise. It means when you're using the Zen method, it always returns a new promise. The fact that it's a new promise is really important, and we'll see just after a while. But it always returns a new promise. That's why we could, we could do a catch after Zen, for example. So you can chain Zen, which is pretty nice. But when you start chaining, when you're calling Zen a second time, what you're getting is not the same promise as this one. This one is another promise that will be resolved with the value returned by the first callback. So here, instead of having the data, you have the user. So it's kind of useful because you can transform your data and progressively use it inside your promise. When you're doing that with another promise, this is better because this promise returned by that call, we'll wait for the promise returned by that call to be resolved. So here, you directly have the user resolved from the getUser async call. So you can chain asynchronous calls without nesting them more and more. So let's use that in our case. For example, right here, we can just return that and reduce the index. So here, we will just return that code, and you can reduce this. We don't need to catch twice the same mistake, so same error, so it's okay. Let's see if it works. Oh, no, it doesn't work. If you have a look right here, it says that user data is not defined. And if you have a look to the code, we need user data at this place, but the user data is in another, is in another scope right now. So we will use a little trick right here. Instead of returning just the user info, we will return user info both user data and user info. And here we have the user data in the good cup, so it should work.
No, but it's not bad.
Where?
Then.
Here? No, it's okay.
Next day.
Sorry?
The next day, you let me open back.
Here?
Yeah. You have two of those.
That's correct.
No, it's okay. I think it's a network of
the best one.
This was a network. Okay, better. So it's a little trick just to have the user data. Is it okay for everybody?
Yeah.
Okay. So that's kind of better, we have less indents. But let's have a look at the function we've seen earlier, the display frame function. This is quite a complex function because what we're trying to do is many calls, many parallel calls, and then execute a callback after every call has been resolved. So what we are doing is iterating over iframes. For each frame, we are trying to get the information, so it's an asynchronous call. And once we receive, each time we receive some information, we're adding it to a frames info array and calling the method done. The method done is a little trick right here. It's a method that we call or true callback once it has been called enough times. That it means once we have called it, the number of friends we have. So it means each time we receive data, we will call the done method. It will increment a counter, and when the counter is equal to the number of friends we have, we will call the true callback that will display my friends. It's very complex, a lot of boilerplate just to do some parallel calls. So what can we do with promise? In promise, you can use the old method that will take an array of promise in parameters and return the promise that will be resolved once every promise in the array has been resolved. Or it will be rejected once one promise is rejected. So here, when you're using the same method, you're sure every promise has been resolved, so the data contains is an array that contains every data reserved for each promise. So at index 0, you have the data for promise 1, at index 1, you have the data for promise 2. So let's use that. Here, we need an array of promise. That's good because right here, we're creating some promise. So instead of using for each, we'll just map that and store it into an array. Okay, now we can use promise.all. And we can now call directly for true callback, that is right here. And we don't need that. Just don't forget to use that error. Okay. So this function now takes our friend as argument. Okay. And we don't need that or that. So we have something really more readable. Here you can see that we're getting a lot of calls and we are trying to execute something once all calls have been resolved. Okay, so that's better. If you have a look right here, the display frame function is used into this method. So if we just returned this promise, we don't need to catch the error right here because it will be catched right here. We can do better and use this for these two calls. So once again, promise.all. and we can only deal with the rock once. And one last time, we can return the promise and only deal with the errors right here. So that's perfect. Now we're dealing with the errors at only one place in our code, which is great. But it's not really great, it's not readable enough for me. So maybe we can use something else in ES6. In ES6, for some other promise method you can use, promise.trace returns a promise that is resolved once one promise is resolved inside your array of promise. Promise.resolve returns an immediately resolved promise. It's useful, for example, to wrap an unknown value into a promise, because if you feed in with a promise, it will stay a promise, but if you give it a raw value, it will become a promise. So it can be good when you don't know what you reset. Promise.reject returns an immediately rejected promise. So what we will use now is a generator. A generator in JavaScript is a function that can stop its execution in the middle of it. For example, you declare a generator with a star, just a simple function, but you have a star before the name. And you have access to a new keyword, the yield keyword, that basically means, okay, I've done everything I needed to do for now, I stopped my execution, call me back when you want me to continue. So here, when we call the generator, it will execute the yield 1, it will return the value 1, and then stop. If you want it to continue, you call the generator again, and it will execute the second instruction, yield 2. It will return the value 2 and stop its execution. If you call it a third time, it will continue. There is no more instruction, so it will finish. How do you use it? You call a first time to create an iterator, and then you can iterate with the iterator.next method. So the first one will receive the value 1 inside an object. So if you access the value, you will have the value 1, and then the value 2. Doesn't seem really useful, but let's see. You can communicate both ways with the generator. It means it can return you some value, but you can feed him some value when you call him back. For example, here we are expecting some value in return of the yield instruction. How does it work? Here, so we are initializing the generator. It will execute the yield 1 and stuff, so we will see the value 1. Then, when you call it, you give it the value hello, for example. The yield 1 will be replaced by the value hello, the string hello, and it will be stored in the constant value. It will continue until the next yield, so it will return 2. And the third time you call it, it will return the value right here, so the string hello. Still not useful, but you can also send some errors into your generators. Here, for example, we're expecting some exception rate. And if you look at the code, you can say instead of iterator.next, just iterator.throw, and it will replace the yield by throw your value. Now, imagine instead of yielding raw value, you start to yield some promise. And imagine the consumer of your generator waits for this promise to be resolved before calling you again. This is exactly what we are expecting here. We're getting some promise, and in return, we're expecting the resolved value of the promise. If you have a look at how it will work, so we're creating our iterator. Right here, we are iterating, getting a promise. And then, we are using the then method to call back the generator only when the promise is resolved. So, right here, we have a code that looks really synchronous. This is exactly what we will do with our code. This mechanism is so useful that there are several libraries in JavaScript that do the exact same job, more complex. The one we will use is named Co. It will wrap your generator inside process of iteration, and each time it will receive the promise, it will wait for the promise to be resolved to call you back, either with a success or with an exception. Okay, so let's use Go inside Docker. So we need to import it. Now we will create a generator. We can create an anonymous one. And let's just put all our code inside. Right here. Nothing has really changed, but now it's code that will execute our code instead of just the code being executed immediately. If you have a look, it still works. Okay, so now we can start to yield some promise. So for example, this one, we can just yield it. And Go will take it, wait for it to be resolved, and then call us back. So we can directly get the user data right here. And we can enter and And as you can see, it's still working, but now it's a bit better because it's really more readable. We're just getting some value from our function. Something we can notice is that we don't need the little trick anymore because user data is in the same scope as this code. So we can remove that. Okay, we can continue and yield this one too. Right here. Okay. And we can even build this one. So now it's still working, and we have a code that looks really more synchronous and that is more readable and maintainable for the user, for the developer. This is so useful, in fact, that people wanted it to be added to the language itself. So, since ES8, it's added directly into the language and it's called an async function. You declare an async function with an async keyword, and you can use await instead of yield inside your function. So, let's do that. Here we don't need Go anymore, so we can import. And we will just create an async function and replace all the yield by some await. The only difference is that you need to call your function. It's not calling it for here. And it still works. One thing we've forgotten is error handling, so let's add it. Remember, it will raise an exception if there is any error, so we can just do a try catch, which doesn't work usually because with asynchronous code it won't be catched, but here you can. Or you can know that an async function returns a promise and just catch the error at it. So here we've got a promise, a code that looks synchronous, even if it's asynchronous, the promise is kept. There is some more thing to come in ES9. Just to remember, ES8 is coming like this month, I think. It's already fixed, so you can use async function without any problem. What is coming in ES9 or ES10 is a mix between async function and generator function. It means it's a generator function that could use the await keyword. For example, the simplest example is reading lines in a file. So for example, you can use await to value 5. Then you will await each line and yield the promise that is returned in your generator. It means your generator, instead of returning the value directly, will return a promise to the value. This is useful when you use the async for the for await loop to iterate, for example, over your function. So here you can do a simple loop and iterate over your file asynchronously. That's kind of beautiful. Okay, but something is missing. Just the proposal is at stage 3, so it has a great chance to be in ES9. But something is missing. We've dealt with very specific use case, which is an HTTP request. But we're using asynchronous in other way in JavaScript. For example, let's take this example. Here, what we want to do is listen to an event on the field and do something each time the input event is read on the field. You can't use promise because once a promise is resolved, you can resolve it again. So you can call the callback many times. So something is missing. In JavaScript, this is coming, and it's called observables. I don't know if you've been to the talk earlier from Benoît Berry, but he was introducing the observables in detail. I won't do that because it's really a big subject, but I will give you some introduction to that. So what is an observable? An observable is an asynchronous data stream. So it's a stream on which events will be raised. So here the stream is represented by this line. You have some events. Here you have 6 events. Some events are just values. Some events can be errors. And you can have the completed stream event. So in the code, how does it work? For example, you can create an observable from an event on an input this way. And then you need to subscribe to that source to get the event and use them. So right here. In JavaScript, what is planned? It's still at stage 1, so it's really uncertain. You have the subscribe meta, the observable.off that will take an iterator of items to create an observable, and the observable.from, I don't remember exactly how it works, but not really. But what you need to notice is that it's really poor in functionality. You must tap a lot of things. It's really basic. So what I will advise you to do is to use RxJS. RxJS is a library that is here since many years. As you can see, describe itself as the reactive extension for JavaScript. What is a reactive extension? It's an API for asynchronous programming with observable streams. It's called reactive programming. It's when you will use data stream to as a paradigm to transform your data. A simple example right here. You have a stream and you will transform this stream with some operators. Here it's a debounce operator. As you can see, it will apply a debounce effect on your event. So it will transform your data progressively and it will transform your data until you have exactly what you want in your application. Each event into another event. So the example, the simple example from earlier is that you will take your event, map it, for example, into the value of the input, and then use the value inside your function. For a more elaborate example, I will show you. Okay. Okay, I have a simple input that will just do research on GitHub. For example, let's search profile. So it will just do a simple research, but in front-end development, nothing is simple. For example, what we want here is that if you have less than 2 characters, it won't do research. If you have, yes, 1 character, it won't do a research. So for example, right here, if I just input 1 character, it won't do any request. You need to have... As you can see, we only doing a request when we have 2 characters. It has a debounce too. It means you won't do a lot of requests until the user has finished typing. And if the value does not change, it will not trigger another code. So there is a lot of logic behind this simple input. And right now, let's have a look at the code. Okay. Right here, you do that with approximately 20 lines of code, which is kind of a lot. So let's try to use observable with that. Yes. So now I will comment this code. Okay, and create a source. So from event, clicking on the input here, listening to the input event. And then just subscribe. What we need to have at the end of our pipeline is the users. Just, and we need just to display them. So first, what we will get here is only a list of events. So we need to map this into a value of the field, so we get some event and we will just map it into a value. Then we need to make a call, so we will flat map it because we will have a promise that we will transform into an observable, and we need flat map to keep it to one level. So we will just take the value, create an observable from a promise, and the promise is right. So here we should have something very simple. Okay, as you can see, we have a request each time we enter. So it's good but not perfect. So what we will do is just debounce it. So right here, we have a simple debounce, it's an operator. Okay, so if you have a look, that's kind of better, we have less requests. What we also need is to reduce, only make the request when there is at least 2 characters. three characters. So we will just use filter. Okay. Let's try it. Better. Okay. And the last one. When the debounce is off, if the value has not changed, we don't want a new request to be read. So we will just use this thing until it changes. So as you can see, what we had with 20 lines of code, you can have it with only 7 lines of code, and it's really more clear to read and more maintainable. There are a lot and a lot of operators. You have a long list of operators if you want to have a little book to read. So I'll leave you some links if you want to explore further the subject. Thank you. Is there any question? Yes?
What about the compatibility in terms of browser and... And also backend, of course.
Okay, you have some compatibility. Ability table for ES6 it's okay like almost everywhere. Only let's see. I think yes, ER11 is not really good, but since Edge you can use it everywhere. For the async function, it's more the latest browser, but you can use Babel to use it everywhere. For Node.js, since version 7, it's okay to use the async function. You can go to Node.green and have a list of everything.